What up, what up, what up? Hey guys. Hey y'all. Okay, first let me lower this. Let me put this on. Let me welcome you to Story Time with Shari. If this is your first time joining, I'm Shari. Shocking, I know. If you're watching with me, say hello in the comment box. Let me know where you're tuning in from. Let us know how you're doing. Share whatever it is that you want to share there. I'm excited to spend this morning, afternoon with you, because the whole point of story time with Shari is literally to take you out from where you are and connect you back to yourself, to joy, to that space within us as children that we really enjoyed. And the reason why I started story time is because of my fifth grade teacher, Miss Wright. Although in sixth grade she became Miss Williams, but she used to read story time to us. Hey guys, say hello. Don't forget to grab your favorite cup of something. Today's cocktail of choice is a cranberry vodka. These are gonna get old after a while if you've been here. No, it's my latte. As you guys may know, that we are at a new time, and the reason why that we are at a new time for story time is because before I wasn't able to get my walks in, and I was rushing to get this started, and I was like, oh no, Sherry, you need some self-care time. So this enables me to be able to take a morning walk, get fresh air, and then still be able to be here on time. Before we get started today, we are going to be reading from Judy Blume, Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing. As I said, this is the book. Judy Blume, in and of herself, is the one that really got me into story time, because my fifth grade teacher, she was such an awesome reader. And I just ordered it from Amazon and I started reading it again. And I was like, yeah, she was much better at this than I was, but whatever. Curious for you guys, because I haven't seen you since last Friday. And the weekend went by, and there's been some interesting times. And I really encourage you to find the silver lining and everything, in case you guys did not notice. My nails are gone. Those beautiful fake purple nails I had were gone, but I was like, find the good in it all. And the good in it all is that I was able to actually pick up a bobby pin and not spend 7 minutes trying to get it with these long ass nails. So that's the silver lining in being able to find the good and not having the nails. Comment in here if you guys can hear me. Because I just want to make sure I don't see anything, and maybe there are no comments, but guys know how I am. I don't want to feel alone in this. If you're feeling grateful today, say yes, put a heart in the comments, let me know. At the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about gratitude, because I want to give thanks to all of the amazing people in the world that are taking care of us, which we'll go into. But if you're feeling inspired to shout something out right now that you're grateful for, please go ahead and do so. Hey, mama, I love you too. Please take care of yourself. Now I'm like your mom. All right, guys. What time is it for my regulars? It's smart girl time. So let's dive into Judy Blume, the world of Peter Warren. Hey, Bill, it's good to see you too. The world of Peter Warren Hatcher and Fudge. This is such a fun book. And I thought that we would focus on one book instead of jumping around, and as soon as we're done with this, we'll go to another one. So Judy Blume, Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing. Kelly, grateful for your health. Thank you, Bill, for letting me know you can hear me. I think I was just feeling sad. No one was saying hi. All right, let's go. You guys ready? The big winner. I won dribble at Jimmy Fargo's birthday party. All the other guys got to take home goldfish in little plastic bags. I won him because I guessed that there were 348 jelly beans in Mrs. Fargo's jar. Really, there were 423, she told us later. Still, my guess was closest. Peter Warren Hatcher is the big winner, Miss Fargo announced. At first, I felt bad that I didn't get a goldfish too. Then Jimmy handed me a glass bowl. Inside, there was some water and three rocks. A tiny green turtle that was sleeping on the biggest rock. All the other guys looked at their goldfish. I knew what they were thinking. They wished they could have green turtles too. I named mine Dribble while I was walking home after Jimmy's party. I live at 25 West 68th Street. It's an old apartment building, but it's got one of the best elevators in New York City. There are mirrors all around. You could see yourself from every angle. There's a soft cushioned bench to sit on if you're too tired to stand. And the elevator's operator name is Henry Bevelheimer. He lets us call us Henry because Bevelheimer is very hard to say. Our apartment's on the 12th floor, but I don't have to tell Henry. He already knows. He knows everybody in the building. He's that smart. He even knows I'm 9 and I'm in 4th grade. I showed him dribble right away. I want him at a birthday party, I said. Henry smiled. Your mother's gonna be surprised. Henry was right. My mother was really surprised. Her mouth opened when I said, just look at what I want at Jimmy Fargo's birthday party. I held up my tiny green turtle. I've already named him Dribble. Isn't that a great name for a turtle? My mother made a face. Oh, I don't like the way he smells, she said. What do you mean? I asked. I put my nose right down close to him. I mean, I didn't smell anything but turtle. So Dribble smells like turtle, I thought. Well, he's supposed to. That's what he is. And I'm not going to take care of him either, my mother added. Of course you're not, I told her. He's my turtle, and I'm the only one who's going to take care of him. You're going to change his water and clean out his bowl and feed him and all of that, she asked. Yes, I said. And even more, I'm going to see to it that he's happy. This time, my mother made a funny noise, like a groan. I went into my bedroom and I put Dribble on top of my dresser. I tried to pet him and tell him he would be happy living with me. But it isn't easy to pet a turtle. They aren't soft and furry and they don't lick you or anything. Still, I had my very own pet at last. Later, when I sat down at the dinner table, my mother said, I smell turtle. Peter, go and scrub your hands. Some people might think that my mother is my biggest problem. She doesn't like turtles, and she's always telling me to scrub my hands. That doesn't mean just run them underwater, by the way. Scrub means I'm supposed to use soap and rub my hands together. Then I've got to rinse and dry them. I ought to know by now. I mean, I've already heard it enough. But my mother isn't my biggest problem. Neither is my father. He spends a lot of time watching commercials on TV. That's because he's in the advertising business. These days, his favorite commercial is the one about Juicy O. He wrote it himself. And the president of the Juicy O company liked it so much that he sent my father an entire crate of Juicy O for our family to drink. It tastes like a combination of oranges, pineapples, grapefruit, pears, and bananas. And if you want to know the truth, I'm getting really sick of drinking it. But Juicy O isn't my biggest problem either. My biggest problem is my brother, Farley Drexel Hatcher. He's 2.5 years old, and everybody calls him Fudge. I feel sorry for him if he's going to grow up with a name like Fudge, but I don't say a word. It's none of my business. Fudge is always in my way. He messes up everything he sees, and when he gets mad, he throws himself flat on the floor and he screams. And he kicks. And he bangs his fists. The only time I really like him is, well, when he's sleeping. He sucks 4 fingers on his left hand and makes a slurping noise. When Fudge saw Dribble, he said, oh, see. And I said, that's my turtle. You get it? It's mine. You don't touch him. Fudge said, no touch. And then he laughed like crazy. One night, my father came home from office all excited. He told us Mr. and Mrs. Yarby were coming to New York. He's the president of the Juicy O company, and he lives in Chicago. I wondered if he'd bring my father another crate of Juicy O. If he did, I would probably be drinking it for the rest of my life. Just thinking about it was enough to make my stomach hurt. My father said he invited Mr. and Mrs. Yarby to stay with us. My mother wanted to know why they couldn't stay at a hotel like most people who come to New York. My father said they could, but he didn't want them to. He thought they'd be more comfortable staying with us. My mother said that was about the silliest thing she'd ever heard. But she fixed up Fudge's bedroom for our guests. She put on fancy sheets and a brand new blanket on the hide-a bed. That's a sofa that opens up into a bed at night. It's in Fudge's room because that used to be our den. Before he was born, we watched TV in there. And lots of times, Grandma slept over in the hide-a bed. Now we watch TV right in the living room, and Grandma doesn't sleep over very often. My mother moved Fudge's crib into my room. He's going to get a regular bed when he's three, my mother says. There are a lot of reasons I don't like to sleep in the same room as Fudge. I found out that 2 months ago, when my bedroom was being painted, I had to sleep in Fudge's room for 3 nights because the paint smell made me cough. For one thing, he talks in his sleep. And if a person didn't know better, a person could get scared. Another thing is that slurping noise he makes. It's true that I like to hear it when I'm awake, but when I'm trying to fall asleep, I like things very quiet. When I complained about having to sleep with Fudge, my mother said, "It's just for 2 nights, Peter." "I'll sleep in the living room," I suggested, "on the sofa or even a chair." "No," my mother said, "you'll sleep in your bedroom in your own bed." There was no point in arguing. Mom wasn't going to change her mind. She spent the day in the kitchen. She really cooked up the storm. She used so many pots and pans, Fudge didn't have any left to bang together. And that's one of his favorite pastimes, banging pots and pans together. A person can get an awful headache listening to that racket. Right after lunch, my mother opened up the dinner table. We don't have a separate dining room. When we have company for dinner, we eat in one end of the living room. When Mom finished setting the table, she put a silver bowl filled with flowers right in the middle. I said, "Hey, Mom, it looks like you're expecting the president or something." "Very funny, Peter," my mother answered. Sometimes my mother laughs like crazy at my jokes. Other times she pretends not to get them. And then there are times when I know she gets them, but she doesn't seem to like them. This was one of those times. So I decided no more jokes until after dinner. I went to Jimmy Fargo's for the afternoon. I came home at 4 o'clock and I found my mother standing over the dinner table mumbling. Fudge was on the floor playing with my father's socks. I'm not sure why he likes socks so much, but if you give him a few pairs, he'll play quietly for an hour. I said, "Hi, Mom, I'm home." "I'm missing two flowers," my mother said. I don't know how she noticed that two flowers were missing from her silver bowl, because there were at least a dozen of them left. But sure enough, when I checked, I saw two stems with nothing on them. "Don't look at me, Mom," I said. "What would I do with two measly flowers?" So we both looked at Fudge. "Did you take Mommy's pretty flowers?" my mother asked him. "No take," Fudge said. He was chewing on something. "What's in your mouth?" my mother asked. Fudge didn't answer. "Show Mommy." "No show," Fudge said. "Oh, yes." My mother picked him up and forced his mouth open, and she fished out a rose petal. "What did you do with Mommy's flowers?" she raised her voice. She was really getting upset. Fudge laughed. "Tell Mommy." "Yum," Fudge said. "Yummy, yummy, yummy." "Oh, no," my mother cried, rushing to the telephone. She called Dr. Cohn. She told him that Fudge ate two flowers. Dr. Cohn must have asked what kind, because my mother said, "Roses, I think, but I can't be sure." "Oh, one might have been a daisy." There was a long pause while my mother listened to whatever Dr. Cohn had to say. Then Mom said, "Thank you, Dr. Cohn," and she hung up. "No more flowers," she told Fudge. "You understand?" "No more," Fudge repeated. "No more, no more, no more." My mother gave him a spoonful of peppermint-flavored medicine, the kind I take when I have a stomach pains. Then she carried Fudge off to have his bath. Leave it to my brother to eat flowers. Kind of wonder how they tasted. Maybe they're delicious and I don't know because I've never tasted one, I thought. I decided to find out. I picked off one petal from a pink rose and I put it in my mouth and I tried to chew it up, but I couldn't do it. I mean, it tasted awful. I spit it out in the garbage. Well, at least now I know I wasn't missing anything great. Fudge ate his supper in the kitchen before our company arrived. And while he was eating, I heard my mother remind him, "Fudgy's gonna be a good boy tonight. Very good for Daddy's friends." "Good, Fudge, good boy." "That's right," my mother told him. I changed and scrubbed up while Fudge finished his supper. I was gonna eat with the company. Being nine has its advantages. All righty, guys. Hey, y'all. Well, okay, so I mean, I could just keep going, but I know that you all have a busy life. And I don't mean that actually sarcastically, but I mean, there's lots to do. Okay, again, that just sounds, whatever, you may have lots to do. I don't have lots to do. The most exciting thing that I did this past weekend was I watched John do a karaoke party. By the way, before I get into all of that and we talk about gratitude, have any of you guys read Judy Bloom? Did you have to read it in school? Is this something you're familiar with? Do you like this book? Talk to me. Tell me what's going on. So while I'm waiting for your answers, if anyone has read Judy Bloom. So this past weekend, which was obviously, I didn't do a show yesterday, a reading yesterday, so I didn't have a chance to tell you, is that we did a karaoke. Well, John did a karaoke party. John decided that it was 5 o'clock somewhere, and so he started having some beer during the day, and then that beer led into wine, and then that wine and beer led into a show. And for anyone who knows my fiance, John is not very outgoing. He's the quiet one out of the two of us. And so he just started, and like 4 hours later, he was dancing and singing, and there were empty bottles around, and he was just having himself a good old time. And I was just so amused by this and by him, because the more drinks he has, the less he remembers the words. So it was a really fun time. And then I finally said, John, I don't think that you should have another drink. And he looked at our cats and he was like, guys, he was like, I think we got a heckler in the front row. And so it was a very amusing weekend. There's a lot that's happening in the world around us, and things that, that are scary and everything. But it's these small moments, that we can learn to appreciate and, see this as a new way of being, in a way. Hey, Lori. Oh, you love Judy Bloom. Oh, Bill, awesome. Yeah, it's a really cute book. This whole series. So she has Tales of a Fourth Grade Nothing, and then it's Fudge, and then there's like five books in this series. So yeah, it gets to be really, it's really cute. So anyway, I'm all over the place. So with all that's happening in the world, I guess we would say, like, to be able to find those small moments, to find the silver lining in things. And for me, this past weekend was being able to just spend that fun time with John. And then after the drinks started flowing, he, put on some different music. He put on some Latin Spanish music, and we started dancing in the living room. Although he did tell me to stop at one point because we were spinning, and he was gonna throw up. So I was like, all right, so he won't spin anymore. I'll just spin. And then he forgot that he had said that, and so he spun again. And so, in the midst of all what could be called chaos, there are these bright spots and these moments and these silver linings. And so as you just continue to go throughout your days, because I know things are getting, a little more nerve-wracking. And I said to my friend yesterday, I said, it feels like it's like this slow creep in, and we're just kind of waiting. And so I just always, and I'm not here to remind you of it. Story time is about disconnecting from it, but I'm also not going to disconnect from reality as well. And so what I want to do is really encourage you during this time to continue to check in with yourself and to continue to find the gratitude and the good, because it really will change your day. Hey Jessica, welcome guys. So I would love for you in the comments on in the chat over here to shout out something that you're grateful for. Yesterday we went to our grocery store, and they do the social distancing and only let a few people in at a time, and they put up the plexiglass in between the cashier and ourselves. And I would just said to John, I was like, police officers and firemen and people who put their lives on the line, go into it knowing. But what about, all the delivery people and, the grocery store clerks and the postal workers and the nurses and the doctors and everybody that are keeping us and our society going? And I just want to shout them out right now because they literally are putting, their lives on the line so all of us can have all the essentials that we need. And so what I would love to ask you all to do is to just keep them close in your hearts and to say a prayer or whatever it is that you do, wrap them in light, whatever works for you. Just continue to think about them, put safety around them, thank them. I know the world is showing up in big ways for people. And I wrote yesterday, I said, it's not a question of whether we will get through this. It's a question if we'll be changed people when we do. And that's really what I will always and continue to encourage you to do, is to take this time to uncover and discover new parts of yourself, to see people in the world in a different way. Because none of us are gonna not have come out of this changed. I'm missing all this. Today we started contacting an interview for their contacts. Mom, thank you, story time. This is something she's grateful for. Bill, your family went to Antelope Island State Park to picnic and see the sunset. Oh, awesome. Beautiful. Yeah, it's so important that we continue to take care of ourselves and continue to feed our souls. And so I want to continue encouraging you to do that. I will be back tomorrow at noon, same time again, noon Eastern, 9 a.m. If this brought a smile to your face, if anything that was said, please hit the share button. I want to let you know that I'm in the process of working out, figuring out a class, a webinar, something that I can do that can assist the community. So in any ideas that you have, please shout it out here. I'm going to do it on a pay what you can basis. So, you know, if you're someone who's not having any financial challenges and you can, you know, donate what you can, that would be amazing. If you're someone who doesn't have any resources right now, you pay what little you can or as much based on the value you find and what I'm offering and the expertise that I have, whatever feels right for you. So just share with me. You can write me privately. You can write it here. Some topics that you would need to cover in a webinar. I hate the word webinar. It sounds like, but anyway. Love Yourself Happy, my book, is still on sale for 99 cents. Make sure you go and grab it. Make sure that you go and grab yourself today. Send yourself a beautiful hug. We all need it. Give it to yourself. Give it to someone that is in your home with you. And stay home. Take care of yourselves. And don't forget to thank all those people who are showing up for us every single day. I'm so grateful for every single one of you. I love you guys. Talk to you tomorrow.